by joining in the praise of Jim Yao and colleagues in setting up this wonderful workshop. Also for me, it's the first time that I actually was able to travel again. In my talk, I would like to basically touch on three materials. I'll start off with SMIMXR borides. We already have heard a lot about this, so I'll concentrate on the topological properties of this material, specifically with magnetic substituent using magnetic tips. And then I'll touch briefly upon two sulfide materials, a Dirac nodal line semi-metal and a half metallic semi-metal. Now the, it was already pointed out that it's really difficult to actually cleave these samples. That was very much elucidated on by Jenny. And so just right now, when Lee talked about this, and it took us several years to actually compile these surfaces here, but the vast majority of these surfaces, what we saw is actually it's very rough, and only small patches are actually ordered or atomically flat. So, but we finally managed to actually see all three different types of surfaces that you can expect if you keep the boron octahedra intact. So we have some Mayan terminated surfaces, boron terminated surfaces, and the 2x1 reconstructed surfaces, either extended or snaking on like this. Well, what we wanted to do is, of course, tunneling spectroscopy. And here we looked for clean areas, because there was already early on the notion that the hybridization gap would be incomplete if you put on a little bit of some Mayan vacancies here. But if you stay away from the defects here, you get nice tunneling spectra here, and you see how the hybridization gap actually evolves as you go down in temperature down to 350 millikelvin, and you see a number of additional peaks. And I want to concentrate on that one here at minus 6.5 millielectron volts, because that carries a significant contribution from the surface states. Also, I should point out that the position and energies of these peaks here are pretty much in line with what later Peter Weil's group published. And that's reassuring for two reasons, because he used floating zone grown samples, so there is no difference in this respect here for the samples. And he also went down to 100 millikelvin, so there's not much going on if you go down in temperature. Now, I mentioned that we want to look at the topography, and our idea was to actually look what happens if we put in magnetic impurities here. Then if the surface states are topological in nature, of course, the breaking of the time reversal symmetry should do something to the surface states in comparison at least to non-magnetic impurities or the pure defect in pure SMIMXR boride. And this is how it looks like if you take a tunneling spectra at or away from the defects here. Of course, if you are sufficient far away, everything looks alike. But then as you approach the defect here in the pure SMIMXR boride, you see there's a little bit of the peak here chopped off, but that's not much. In contrast here at the gadolinium impurity here, the peak is almost completely gone. It's not gapped, so we have some bulk contribution, but it's very much reduced. And to actually quantify that a little bit better here, I show here the height of the peak in dependence on the distance from the impurity. The impurity is located here at zero. And you see for the impurity in pure SMIMXR boride, they're a little bit going down here, 25% or so. For yttrium here, a non-magnetic impurity, it's already a little bit more enhanced, but the real, let's say, action is here for the gadolinium, where you have a reduction of 75%. Now, how can we understand that? There was a model developed for bismuth selenide, bismuth tellurides with magnetic impurities. And you see here at low energies, and we certainly are at low energies here, it looks very much like our results. The main ingredients in this model actually are the exchange interaction, of course. This is the exchange interaction between the Dirac electrons and the magnetic impurity. We have the Fermi velocity, and we have the suppression length or healing length, how Sackfist like to call that. So we got in touch with Zhongxing Liu from Penn State, and he helped us with fitting these data. So this is the result of a fit. And what we get is the exchange interaction energy here of 1.4 millielectron volts and a Fermi velocity of about 3000 meters per second. But most importantly, the suppression length here is for the gadolinium significantly larger compared to the non-magnetic impurities, or let's say a defect, if you wish, in pure samarium hexaboride. And that can be nicely compared to what Jenny has talked about on Monday. She pointed out that the Dirac cone is actually located at minus 5 millielectron volts. So if you add the additional energy here of 1.4, you are exactly at the 6.5 millielectron volts. Also, the Fermi velocity we measure is in the middle between what Jenny actually gave for the Fermi velocities. Okay, then of course the question is, why do we have a suppression even for non-magnetic impurities? And here I can cut short because Jenny also alluded very much on the Kondo-Hole effect. So I don't need to go into that. So how can we now put into perspective? Well, let's look at the surface of our doped samples. And then if we have magnetic doping, we disturb the surface state in a certain area. But if the impurities are of a small enough number, of course, we still have percolating paths here such that we do see at low temperature the saturation. This is here for 0.5% gadolinium and for 3% yttrium. And you can see it can be nicely scaled on top of each other. Yeah, and you can put in here a little bit more of non-magnetic impurities because they aren't destroying the surface state over such a large area. Now, if you go higher up in doping, then of course, at some point you destroy the percolating path and then you don't see the saturation anymore. That happens at 3% gadolinium doping. For non-magnetic doping, you would need to go to something like 12 or 13%. The sample that we have is 18%. You see it's no saturation, but you also see a problem with that approach. If we go around like this, how do we actually know we do not play with the underlying Kondo effect by doping, at least locally? So we certainly introduce inhomogeneity, and are we actually certain we look at the impurity we think at? We have statistics, but that alone, well, okay. So what we learned is that it's actually the exchange interaction between the magnetic entity and the Dirac electrons. So why not moving the magnetic entity out of the sample onto the tip? So we started to play around with chromium tips, and here's the result that you get for the spectroscopy with a tungsten tip. That's what I've shown you before. And then you see the chromium tip, and the surface states here are very much diminished, as you can see. There is this additional feature here, but we think that's due to the density of states of the chromium tip, actually. There is something to be said. It's certainly not related to any stray field or something like that. It's an antiferromagnet. You would not expect this, but nonetheless, for comparison, I show here what you get with a tungsten tip at 12 Tesla. So there's not much going on in 12 Tesla here. Well, still the question could be, well, we have to change the tip. How can we make sure that we are really actually measuring the very same surface? I mentioned in the beginning that we are have difficulties in actually finding nice patches. So what came to help here is the following observation. And this is only true, what I'm going to talk about is only true for the gadolinium tip sample. If we start with a tungsten tip, and we start tunneling and see the spectra here like this. This is what we always observed, just the same thing. But then on the gadolinium dope sample, it happened every once in a while that we picked up something, and you see that in the topography. And then the spectra changed significantly, as you can see here. This peak here is completely gone. The curves here are off for to actually show the curves better. Now, the nice thing with that picking up is that you can actually get rid of it again. If you apply a pulse to your tip, you remove the gadolinium again, and then you recover what you originally have. So you can really play with that. So each of these three investigations I have shown has its shortcomings. But if you put them together, I think there is sufficient proof that if we have a magnetic impurity or entity here, then we really can destroy the surface states. And that's also seen here if we compare the spectra with a picked up gadolinium tungsten tip or gadolinium on a gadolinium impurity. It very much looks like what we see with a tungsten tip at 20 Kelvin, at 20 Kelvin, we think that the surface states have not developed yet. You would need to go to lower temperature. And just to show what we are dealing with right now, or what we are playing with right now, we have some iron hexafluoride samples, FIPT, focused ion beam treated, and you see here with an increasing number of lines. So what we are driving here is actually what we can see, any confinement of the surface or something like this. Well, we are not quite there yet, because the closest we could get so far with our FIPT is a line distance of 15 micrometer. You can see that here, probably the bars are 500 micrometers, but the mean field path is in the order of 1 micrometer. Nonetheless, you already see that the resistivity here is going up at low temperature. You don't know whether that's due to disorder we introduced by fibbing, or whether that's already something we are after. So we need to work on that a little bit further. Now, let me switch gears now and put on some results for hafnium silicon sulfide. That's a Dirac sample metal with a line node, with line nodes here. That's coming about by the non-symmorphic space group of some of these materials. And there's quite some interest here. I only listed a few of these materials here. There's really, it's really a lively area of research. We wanted to look into this class of materials because we can nicely play here with the constituents. You can go from zirconium to hafnium, playing with the spin orbit coupling, and you can actually play with all the chalcogenides here. And I should also mention, in this type of materials, we have quite a significant Rushbaugh spin orbit coupling here, quite a large significant coupling here. And I should also mention, after dealing with some iron hexafluoride, I was fed up with problems in cleaving. This is a 2D, quasi-2D crystal structure, so it cleaves very nicely here between the sulfur. And indeed, we get our nice surfaces as shown here. So you have large areas without any defect, and that's really nice. And you can do a nice spectroscopy and so on. Again, I've already mentioned that we have sulfur terminated surfaces. And then we see different types of defects here. You see, for instance, here the square one and this one again here. So we can actually think about models, what's going on and so on. But that's not what I want to drive at. I want to go into spectroscopy. So away from the defect, we see a V-shaped spectra, overall V-shaped, which is, of course, expected for semi-metal. So we did some band structure calculations, so that's slab DFT calculations here, and the results are shown here. So you see the Rushbaugh split surface states here. And actually, I should point out that these are pretty large range of energy. They are up to 2 eV linear linear dispersing. We have quite a good agreement for some of the features between the calculated results and the experimental results here. For instance, for the Fraunhofer singularity here, and also for this other peak here. But I should also point out that in the calculations, we have no indication for this peak here at about minus 70, minus 80 millielectron volts. There's nothing here. That's probably due to a coupling of the surface electrons with some collective mode. There is some talk in the literature about coupling to surface phonons here, for instance, by the Japanese group. And that might actually be the reason why we see why there is some mass enhancement being observed for the zirconium sister compound. And also in the calculations, we have a peak here at the Fermi level that's not seen in our experimental results. So band structure calculation is okay, but it doesn't reproduce everything we see actually. But what's really interesting to me is if we switch on a magnetic field, you see oscillations here in the DIDV near the Fermi level. So if you look at this a little bit more in detail, you see they kick in at about 7 Tesla, and they get much more pronounced if you increase the field. Of course, if we have a 2D surface state, we expect Landau quantization here. And the amplitude should fade away very quickly because we have the quasi-particle lifetime here being inversely proportional to the energy distance square here. I should also mention that similar oscillations have been seen in MR. And in order to visualize that here, we have a background subtracted and the curves offset just to make it more visible. Now, let's get back to the defects I have talked about. So in the following, I will go along this line here and show spectroscopy results and see what happens. So here you see a few of the oscillations that I have shown before. The color go up here, don't show up very well here. That's too bad. So we go along the line here. So this distance can be actually thought of in nanometers. And then here we have the bias voltage and see the oscillations here by the color code. So clearly, oscillations are seen at some of these defects. They are a little bit influenced, but this defect here is really bad. It doesn't look like it, but it really destroys all the oscillations here. We don't see anything right at this particular impurity. Now, we also see some oscillations here where we think the collective mode is located. And all of this, I think, is pointing out that we have a Rajpa parameter, which is very sensitively influenced by the impurities that we see specifically at this one here. Now, if you look carefully into the data, for instance, here at minus 26 millivolts, you see that there is a phase shift here. You see a maximum here and here, and that would also be the case in the on a clean lattice side. But here in the near this defect here, we have a minimum. So we know that the lambda levels are, the width of the lambda levels are inversely proportional to the quasi-particle lifetime. So we have an increased width here. And that of course points to some scattering here at this defect here. That's also seen in bismuth telluride for comparison. Now, what we can do now is to further analyze these oscillations is we know from ARPES and our band structure calculations that we have a quasi-linear dispersion with the crossing point here located at minus 400 millielectron volts. So we can do a fitting of the Fermi velocity and the number of the Landau level here. And we get up with, we come up with these numbers here. Unfortunately, at the Fermi level, we are not able to observe the low number lambda levels. I should also mention that we neglected the Zeeman splitting here. Now, another type of defect that was in real space, but now another type of defect that we actually observed is such a step edge here. And that's very nice because then you can look at how standing waves are formed. The interesting thing here is that this step edge here is oriented at a strange angle. The crystallographic axes are along this red line here, and the angle is about 55 degrees. I honestly don't understand that how there can be a step edge along this angle. I don't know, but that's what we observe. Now, these are the pattern, the standing wave pattern, as I already mentioned. And of course, that's an invitation to do Fourier transform. Now, again, here, the color plot for distance from the step edge and the bias voltage, and you see the oscillations here. And if you do the Fourier transform, you see here the line coming down here, as you would expect. If you do a linear extrapolation, you come to the minus 400. And also the Fermi velocity here, this number, if I may go back, I hope it's not taking too much. Oh, yeah, here it was. It's pretty close to what we got from the other type of defect. So that's a nice agreement, actually. And now to actually point out what's going on here is this is a result from ARPES, from Chinese group, actually collaboration Chinese Oxford. And you see here the Rajpa split surface states. These are the cones here, located at minus 400 millielectron volts. And we are basically looking at scattering here. And if you now zoom into that, you see the Rajpa split surface state. And if we again take the strange angle, we can scatter from here to here and get actually the good agreement to what we expect from, or what we got from our scattering experiments. So if I may have two more minutes, I will briefly show some results on the cobalt tin sulfide. That's a Kagome lattice here, and it's also a nice 2D structure, so nice for SDM investigations. But what we are interested in, or what got us into this, is actually it's supposed to be a half metallic ferromagnet. So that actually caught our attention. It cleaves relatively nicely. Quite often, you see the sulfur terminated surface. Every once in a while, you also get to the more interesting cobalt Kagome lattice, but that's only observed on very thin samples, and that can, there's a lot of work being published lately on this type of materials, STM. What I want to point out here is what happens if we do spin polarized STM. So we put on a magnetic field of plus or minus 3 tesla. Of course, the sample magnetization will switch. If you have a chromium tip, there's not much going on in the magnetization of the antiferromagnetic chromium. So we have either parallel or antiparallel spin alignment. We don't know that which one it is actually, but we clearly see differences here for plus and minus 3 tesla. And that points to spin polarization here. Of course, the spin filter, the tip come into play here. And we can compare that to band structure calculations, GAN slab calculations. And here the minority spin direction shows the expected gap here just at the Fermi level. And that's nicely comparable to our red experimental data here. Now, if we calculate here the spin polarization from that, you see the agreement is only, well, decent or whatever you call that. But particularly here in this regime, there isn't a good agreement if we take the spin polarization of the tip of about 0.55. And that's typically the number that's obtained for chromium at tips. So there is, well, room for improvement, but of course I completely neglected the energy dependence of the tip polarization here. Now, before I got to the summary, I would like to acknowledge my collaborator. The sulfide samples came from in-house. Some ammonium hexaboride came from Priscilla or Zach. And the main work was actually done by Lin Zhao now at the Highfield Lab in Los Alamos and my other two postdocs, Victoria and Sahana. And with this, I think I just put up the summary and look forward to your questions.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Steven, may I ask for the last part where you did the calculation for the spin polarization? Is that based on DFT?
Yes, this is DFT, without, slab calculations, yeah.
Without any correlation effect, just,
excuse
just
me,
straight what? Up DFT, no correlation.
No correlation, no, okay. No. No, this is just, let's say, well, I mean, we did it ourselves, so it's quick and dirty, I say that. If someone else had done it, I wouldn't say it.
I have a quick question on the percolation picture for the yttrium defect.
Yes.
The main hexaboride.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, maybe, just a question. So, when you had sort of the scanning, like the scanning, the STM data moving away from the defect, like
yeah.
the extent of that gap being assessed was something like 1.5 nanometers, something like this. Is that right?
For the non-magnetic impurities, we found something like 1.5, I think. Well, actually, yeah. We aren't quite sure because we don't have that dense number of data points. And for the gadolinium, it was 2.2. Let me, yeah, maybe I better get back to the, yeah.
Okay, but I mean, roughly, I mean, I was just saying, I mean, the question is that sort of consistent with the sort of 18% defect level necessary to break the percolative threshold of the surface state?
As I mentioned, we would expect, you know, that to happen at 12, 13%. That's what we kind of estimated, but we didn't have that sample around. So that's why I'm showing the result for the 50 or 18% actually.
Okay.
It was.
So it's roughly consistent.
Roughly, yes, yes. I mean, don't take these numbers too seriously, yeah?
Yeah. Okay. I have one question regarding the hafnium.
Okay.
Silicon sulfide. So there are papers, you know, from the Highfield and quantum oscillation. So those group people basically essentially said the DFT calculation pretty well captured in the band structure. But then I'm trying to understand, you know, what is the origin of the V-shaped density states of V-shaped. V-shaped density state. You have, you know, minimum and the Fermi energy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but then why, you know, if assume, you know, the if we capture, you know, the bad features still, you know, why there is a big discrepancy is
yes, in Fermi. Yes. Yeah. I mean, if you look into the calculations, you would expect this or you find that this peak is coming from bulk states. Yeah. Whereas we here after our SCM, we are of course looking at surface states. Yeah. And that's the main difference here, we think. Yeah. But you know, it's clear that in our calculations we did, this lab wasn't too big. I mean, we had 10 unit cells and one angstrom vacuum. So you can certainly improve on that one, but we think that's coming from the bulk. Yeah. And that's then different from the surface.
Thanks.
Okay, yeah, any last question?
Such a beautiful talk. I have so many questions, but about the gadolinium on the tip, did you try to do it with different setup conditions so that you were looking at?
Yes.
And so you saw the progression as you moved closer that you were progressively destroying the Fano resonance? Does my question make sense? Right. See.
I mean, we did that for the chromium tip, but not for the gadolinium.
Okay. Well, so one or either one seems fine.
Yeah.
So you did see the.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Different set point. Increasing distances and so on. Yes.
Okay. Or,
yeah.
Great. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's it. Thank you. The next talk we have Sarah Griffey. So okay. She used to be here, but now she's gone. New affiliation, yeah.